Hello everybody, my name is Ronan Kerriel. I'm a researcher at the Xilinx Research Labs, and I will present you a C++ compiler for Xilinx FPGA, and I will also introduce you a little bit what is C++ single source programming model. So nowadays, the real frontier is the power wall and the speed of light because of this obvious current physical limit. So the power consumption is now at a point where you cannot power on all the transistors without having your IC melting. And also, accessing external memory consumes a lot of energy. And even moving data inside a chip costs you a lot of energy compared to a basic computation. And of course, the speed of light is a hard limit. And even if you consider that now the chips are multi-gigahertz chips, it's even moving data across the whole chip is an issue. So that's why we have to change the hardware organization and then the software used to program them. Basically use more locality, hierarchy, and massive parallelism. That's why we have all these NUMA and distributed memories. And for example, in the OpenCL world, we have this new address spaces, such as the global, non-current memory, things like that. And we have also this new way of programming models, such as processor in memory, because if you can do some computation inside the memory controllers or the memory DIMMs themselves, you can, of course, prevent transferring all the data at a very high energy cost. And of course, we can see a lot of architecture specialization with a lot of ad hoc accelerators. And we can also now control the power of all these architectures, as I will describe. So if you look at what we have nowadays in some FPGA, such as the board with the pink board we have here, so it's basically an MPSoC. You have, for example, four big ARM cores. And actually, the guy is doing the compilers for the ARM is there, so but it's talking. So, but and we have also some small ARM core. We have even a GPU. We have, of course, a lot of various hardware controllers. And the most interesting part is obviously the programming logic, where you can synthesize whatever you want into the circuits. And you have also some specialized block of RAMs with different characteristics, even DSP blocks I will describe later, and a lot of I/O. That's where FPGAs are very interesting to interact with a lot of external devices and things like that. And we have also some video codec to do some video transcoding and things like that. So as I said, in these circuits, you can adapt the power consumption by switching on and off whatever you want during the computation. That means that you can have a programming model where you can control the what you really switch can switch on or off. The basic programming logic is made by an array of cell logic blocks that you can program, and each cell is actually can implement any boolean of several entries plus some registers, and you have an array of all these devices. That's why it's called a field programmable gate array, with some specialized zone where you can have some RAM, some DSPs and things like that. To add more performance. So DSP blocks are basically this kind of structure where you have predefined multipliers and optimized adders just to implement some, for example, floating point operation or things like that more efficiently than the plain logic. So it's very old now. It's more than 30 years old. But of course, now at that time it was only an 18 megahertz device, but with the time, we have something which is 100 faster with 10,000 more logic, and of course the price per cell has also diminished. So the issue is that everything there is programmable. So what can we do to solve this issue? Of course, there are, we have a lot of tools. For example, you can program at the low level the programmable logic. We have at a higher level a synthesis, high-level synthesis tool, which is named HLS, Libado HLS, that can take C, C++, and be compiled into DSP and lookup table configuration and so on. What is more interesting here at the Kronos booth is that we can also support OpenCL with the SDAXL tools. We have also some language little bit similar to OpenMP with Pragmas, which is called SDSOC. We can synthesize some routers with SDNet. We have also various specialized libraries. And since you have ARM cores, you can run a classical multi-core CPU application with Linux. And we support the OpenMP, OpenAMP protocol to control this small ARM core from the biggest one. Okay. So I talked about OpenCL, and OpenCL is made by the Kronos Group. We are on the Kronos Group booth here, which it's a working group with a lot of different vendors and people from the academia trying to connect basically the software to the silicon by doing a lot of open standards for graphics, for 3D, for machine learning and vision, and for computation. And OpenCL is the most obvious example. But here I will more talk more about SQL. So if we want to program at a higher level this very heterogeneous architectures, we have to pick a language. Of course, you have always an entry cost when you have to switch to a new language, but because you have to rewrite your application. But that's not always the main issues, because if you look backwards, there are thousands of dead parallel languages. So maybe the real issue is the exit cost, because if you pick a technology and then it is deprecated, then your project is dead and you have to reverse all the optimizations that you made for this language, and it's very costly. So my point is that to advocate toward more standard solution with open source implementation. So I don't know if you remember C++, so in two lines, we can say it allows you a direct mapping to the hardware with a zero overhead abstraction. And actually, it has a really very unique positions inside the embedded system world, because it can really control the full stack. And actually, in C++ rebooted in 2011, and now we have a new version every 3 years, and it's quite simpler to use and quite more powerful. I will move away my mouse. And what is interesting is that it can interoperate with a lot of different things. And you can really control the full stack, but without paying what you do not need, actually. We have open source production grade compilers such as GCC and C-Lang and LLVM, and actually the guy doing the ARM compiler for the ARM is just there. And we can, in C++, we can add a lot of new behavior in the program by using classes to define domain-specific embedded languages. Of course, it do not target directly FPGAs, GPUs, or DSPs, but it is extensible with this concept of DSCL. You can also use pragmas and attributes, but it's it does not well compose with C++. And if we look at what is modern C++, for example, you can you create a vector quite easily in one line. In C++ 17, you can see that you do not have to specify the type because the compiler can infer the type and decide, oh, of course, it's a vector of integer. If you do that in all C++, it's maybe 6 lines of code. And then you can iterate on all the vectors or the element of the vector, and you can even modify it by using auto ampersand to get a reference on the element. If we compare, for example, to Python, it's very similar. But in Python 3, for example, it's interpreted. So if you define a function add xy to return the sum, it's actually a generic function in Python. That means that you can call add, for example, with the integer, and it will return, for example, 5 in that case. But if you call add with some strings, it will concatenate the strings. But if you mix and match an integer and a string, it will fail at runtime. And that's very bad, for example, for embedded system, because it may be the braking system of your car, so you do not want to fail. But if you do this in modern C++, that's very terse too. You can express this by just putting auto everywhere, so it's a generic lambda in C++, to return x plus y of any type, and then you can use it in the same way in Python. And if you try to mix and match integer and strings, actually it does not compile. That means that you can detect quite early the error by the typing system. So it's very interesting to have this terse generic programming with type safety without having to use this old-fashioned trauma template stuff. And with generic lambda, we can make some very interesting stuff that I will detail later, how to generate, to write a generic executor in SQL. For example, you can write this lambda expression, which is generic in the term of the type, but also in the numbers of arguments. That means that with this, we take any number of elements or of the arguments, and then with these three dots, we interpolate the plus on all the arguments. And then it will sum all the arguments, whatever their types is. And then we can call, for example, add 1 to 3, it will return 6. Or you can add, for example, 2 to 3. So it's very powerful, and it's very interesting to build a new DSEL on top of that. So, up to now, in this modern C++ environment, there is no environment to address this heterogeneous computing stuff, such as what is defined in the subgroup 14 of ISO C++, which is targeting low latency, HPC, embedded world, and things like that, heterogeneous computing. There is nothing to address this in a single source way. Single source, as I will show you later, is required to have a good programming productivity, because you can really write some generic libraries. And we want also to have an open standard, so that's why it's done inside Kronos. Plus, we want OpenCL interoperability, so that we can also recycle the whole OpenCL ecosystem. So that's it, OpenCL SQL, C++. So a complete example of matrix addition written in this language looks like that. So we have some data that we want to add, which are just two-dimensional array of float, whatever, that we initialize here. And we wrap this data into some buffers. So to be able to be handled by the SQL framework. What a kernel is actually an asynchronous task that we submit on a queue. A queue is just a way to send some work on some device on your system. And so we can submit a lambda function where you define what are the arguments of your kernel and how they will be used. And inside, you have another lambda that will you will launch, for example, here with a parallel for that will execute this kernel code on a range of n by m, and it will operate on this kernel accessor ka and kb, which are defined here. Here we define that actually ka will access in read mode the buffer A. And at the end, we produce C with KC. And when all this block of code exit, SQL will automatically copy back, if required, the data from the buffer C to the vector C. And you will be able to write the results. That means that you will have an automatical wait inserted if the data is not ready. Okay, so SQL, it's a pure C++ DSL where you implement a lot of interesting concepts for heterogeneous computing. So we have this concept of asynchronous task graph plus some hierarchical parallelism where you have this two level of OpenCL parallelism mapping, such as you have the work group and you have work item in them. We have some queues to direct computation to some devices, and it is single source. That means that it looks like CUDA and OpenMP on steroids. Basically, the code is compiled for host and devices, which means that you can have the same code running on the host if you do not have any device at some point, for example. So it's really a system-level programming CL. So the buffers are here to define location-independent storage. And what is interesting is that compared to OpenCL, we can have the buffers, the data in buffers moving across the different devices, even from different vendors. Of course, it might be less efficient that it if it was the same vendors, but at least it allows you to do that in a transparent way. And we have this concept of accessors as a proxy object to address the data that will define the access mode. And we have also some hierarchical storage, like in OpenCL, we can optimize the kernel to use some local memory and things like that. And basically what it gives you, it's all the modern C++ environment plus some OpenCL interoperability. And it, since it is a directly executable DSL, that means that you do not need a specific compiler at least to run on the CPU. That means that you can emulate your system or you can debug your code directly on the CPU without any device compiler first. But what is really interesting is this asynchronous task graph model in SQL. For example, if I change my matrix addition code to have some separate kernels that will do the initialization, so we can have, for example, init A kernel that will write through an accessor to a buffer, and the matrix add will use with a read accessor this buffer to produce another buffer with a write accessor. Actually, the SQL runtime can infer the dependency graph directly from these accessors. And it will derive some schedule to guarantee that all the dependencies are correct. And so the same code with three different tasks, asynchronous tasks, can be written like that, where you will have the initialization of A through the A accessor on buffer A that will write. The initialization of B will write in another accessor pointing to B. And since here we are using A and B in read mode, this kernel will wait for the other one to be executed automatically. And at the end, I request an access on the host side to C through an through an host accessor, and then it will wait on the host that for the all the computation to be executed. So it's very powerful and very terse to write single source code. But what is also interesting is that we have this OpenCL interoperability mode that allows interaction with OpenCL, Vulkan, OpenGL, and all the and a lot of other standards without any overhead. But what is interesting is that you can basically write OpenCL code if you want, while keeping some of the high-level features of SQL, such as you do not have to do the explicit buffer transfers and things like that. And at the end, it might be useful, for example, on the FPGAs to recycle some OpenCL kernels that you have already optimized for your target. For example, we have at Xilinx a lot of different libraries optimized to do some machine learning, vision, linear algebra, things like that. So SQL OpenCL interoperability mode will ease the use of that. So just an example of the same code using OpenCL interoperability. So basically the task is submitted almost in the same way. So we have this parallel form. Now we do not have a lambda here, we have a kernel. And the kernel actually is created here from, well, I use a boost compute program just to ease the generation of the kernel from the source. But basically, okay, that's a normal OpenCL code. And I still use the concept of the accessors to avoid the need of explicit data transfers. But I have to use this set args function to connect, for example, the accessors on A on the first parameters of my kernel. So it's no longer single source, so I have to use this API to do the gluing. Okay, the implementation. There are three known implementations of SQL. The most serious one is made by CodePlay. So it's based on Clang LLVM and a lot of runtime. It generates some Spear portable intermediate representation, which is basically LLVM 3.4 IR plus some decoration. And it can run on any OpenCL device supporting Spear and any CPU. And they have some big applications such as TensorFlow using it. There is also another implementation, SQL GTX, which is made by this guy, actually. it's open source, but it's not complete because there is no outlining compiler. There are some macro hacks to with a different syntax. And I work on the third one, which is Tricycle, I will describe now. So it's an open source implementation based on C++ 17 templated class that I started when I was at AMD and now going on at Xilinx, because at that time I was participating to the ChronoSQL group and it was so complex, so nobody was able to know if it was correct C++. So just to make some slides, I started this to be sure that it was at least compiling and be correct. So, but it evolved in a real prototype. And basically, I use OpenMP to accelerate the host with some parallelism. And I use Boost Compute for the OpenCL interaction. And I have a device compiler for the Xilinx FPGA that I will describe now. So it's a pure C++ implementation for the runtime. So for now, the task graph is implemented with threads plus conditional variables. So it's not very efficient, but I plan to improve that in the future. And I have some few extensions, for example, to express some designing of a TL extension, such as blocking pipes. And there is an ongoing implementation of the device compiler based on CLang and LLVM. So the architecture of the compiler is basically you take your SQL code and you use a pure header runtime, pure C++, and you can execute this code on the CPU by using any modern C++ compiler. It will work. But if you want to run this on the device, then you have to go to a real device compiler that will basically split your code between the host part and the device part. So basically, the kernels will be compiled into some device code. So I have some LLVM passes that will basically just select the kernels and generate some spear 2.0. And then I can send spear to any OpenCL vendor supporting it, and I can generate some binaries from them. And I will do a similar thing on the host part, but removing the device and replacing the kernel by some serialization of the arguments. And then I will mix all that stuff in the final execution. So if I start the same code and I want to run this on an FPGA, for now I still have a limitation on my compiler because on the CLang I have to replace some runtime on the fly, so it's quite hard. So for now I have to write these three lines, but okay, it's ongoing. Then I can generate this Spear 2.0 with a Clang 3.9, which is basically what you have in the output of a normal LLVM compiler, except, for example, if you look really carefully, you have Spear kernel as a coding convention of these programs. You can get the iteration of the inner loop is here, basically. On, we have the 300 iteration. And in Spear, we have a few decorations that will explain what are the arguments of the kernel, the read-write mode, and things like that. And when you put that into the Xilinx tools, we have this nice diagram where we have the tricycle kernel in the center, plus some glue that has been added to the kernel just to have this running on the FPGA. So for example, here we have the memory axis bus, which is connected to the memory, and we have the multiplexer, basically, of all the device parts that request the memory, and we have the controlling glue of the kernels. And then we can look at the FPGA layout, and you can zoom inside of that stuff. And you can see all the wires. And in yellow, it's actually the kernel. So we have the glue here. And then all that stuff is actually the PCI interface and the memory bus that has been synthesized by the. And then you can execute it on the real FPGA, so it's it's a PCI card inside a normal PC. Bon, not very interesting because it's just a simple vector addition. Okay, behind the curtain, so the design for all that stuff, but to be open source and to rely on as much open source software as possible, and to use the most modern tools because it's useless to reinvent something that has been already solved. Make everything as possible at the C++ library and runtime level. And when it's not enough, to do some write some LLVM passes. And when it was not enough, message the Clang AST, that's where I am crying now. That's why I still I've not completed fully the device compiler. So it's all open source. You can look at it, and of course you can contribute. Basically, the device compiler for now is implemented in Makefile, where we on the kernel side we apply different LLVM passes. On the host code, which is a kernel caller, we apply some other passes, and at the end we combine everything and it runs. So, okay, so what is interesting in SQL is that you can really write some generic C++ library. So now I will show you the most complex C++17 code of the presentation. For example, just imagine that you want to create a generic vector addr of anything, taking any number of whatever you want. It's not possible to do this in OpenCLC or OpenCL C++ or whatever, but it's possible in SQL. Actually, you do that because it's single source. That's why Thrust is possible to be written in CUDA. It's possible in C++, AMP, HCC, and so on. And that's why we'll explain in another talk why TensorFlow use CUDA, SQL, or HCC, and not plain OpenCL. So in 25 lines of SQL, C++17, you can write a generic adder. So just focus on the use case for now. For example, I want to write generic adders that will take, for example, UNV. And UNV are, for example, in that case, a vector of int and a vector of float, and you want to display the result like that. But why not taking a vector of double plus a set of char and a list of floats and call generic adder, and you want that to be executed on the device. So how to do that? Well, we've seen this generic lambda, so we can start with that. So auto dot 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 input. At some point, we have to wrap all our data into some buffers. So the way to do some aggregate things in C++ is to use tuple. So here I use BoostANA. BoostANA is the most extreme metaprogramming library to be used nowadays. If you want to do metaprogramming, forget about anything, you have to use BoostANA, which is made by an amazing guy working at Amazon, which is just crazy. So basically, I create here a tuple of buffer, which is constructed from the input, and I do this with all my inputs by just adding these three dots. Okay. I define the computation example plus operator on all the elements of my argument, which is implicitly a tuple, and I use this metaprogramming function from ANA, which is fault left, which is basically apply plus recursively on all my arguments. Okay, then I will skip that, but for now I want to submit my my computation, and what I do is just okay. I have to construct all the accessors in read mode from my buffers, and I use this fancy BoostANA transform to apply this lambda expression, which is just get for each buffer the accessors, and it will construct for you a new tuple of accessors from the tuple of buffers, okay? And now we can create a write accessor on our output buffer, and then we can execute our kernel that will just basically compute first. We have to extract the operands. The operands is just accessing the ith element of all the accessors. on the tuple of accessors, so that's why I have to use this transform. And then the elementary computation is just applying compute on my tuple of operands and writing the ith element on my output accessor. Okay. What I've not explained now is how I define the type of my output. Actually, to figure out what is the type of the output is just doing a computation, an elementary computation on all the inputs, and just asking the C++ compiler about, oh, what is the type of the operation? So that's why here I compute a pseudo result, which is basically applying the compute operation on the tuple, which is just made by, why not, all the first elements on all the inputs. So then I say that my return value type is just the declaration type of my pseudo result. And since it's never evaluated, C++ optimizer will just throw away the computation, but will keep the types. And then I can just allocate my, I create my output buffer, and it will just run. So 25 lines of C++ 17, high-end metaprogramming, but that's very simple with Booth HANA. So because there is, template here. Well, okay. I use three times only the word template, but basically it's this kind of code that show you the power of single source C++. And that makes this possible. And if you see, oh, okay, yeah, it can only add things. Yeah, but maybe we can generalize it by, okay, now we could take an operation that would be passed as a parameter, and actually it's still 25 lines of code, and our for left is just, instead of having plus, it's just using operand. And for example, here I have my generic executor. So I apply to UNV this return X plus Y, so it does the stuff. But here I can, on this computation, I can use some other function. And that explains you how you can define generic executors and do some kernel fusion and do some a complex kernel of vision or machine learning stuff. And actually, that's what is done in TensorFlow in Eigen. And if you are really interested in hardware synthesis, this metaprogramming stuff can be used as a design tools of the hardware itself. For example, if you look at Booth HANA for left, I use, basically that makes that, this computation. But there are a lot of metaprogramming algorithms available in HANA. For example, you could decide to do a divide and conquer approach. So basically, you could create an hierarchy in your computation. So that means that you could synthesize Wallace 3 in the hardware. Or even better, you could sort all the arguments according to their types. And you could even, for example, sorting the arguments by their size. And then you could minimize the hardware generated by just doing the by putting all the small arguments together first and adding the bigger later on. So that's just amazing. And of course, you can do the more classical stuff, such as implementing some kernel fusion, pipeline execution, and that's what basically is done in Vision CPP, so the Vision libraries from CodePlay, or Eigen, Align, and things like that. And actually, in the next version of C++ 20, you will have a lot more stuff on introspections, metaclasses, and then we will be able to do quite more stuff. So just imagine that System C has been invented when there was only maybe not even C++ 98. But imagine System C invented today. It would be completely different. Okay, so that's why this made possible to have TensorFlow SQL, which is the machine learning and open source environment by Google, that first was using only CUDA for GPUs. But with some effort between Google and CodePlay in 2015, now there is a port, an official port of TensorFlow SQL. And so it's upstream the normal version of SQL, and we are interested in this for our FPGA too. For example, with TensorFlow SQL, you can specify that this description of a TensorFlow graph, which is here written in Python, you can say with this device specifier, you can say, oh, I want this code executed on this SQL node, I want this executed on this CPU node, and so on. And there is this TensorBoard nice environment, like anything that Google does, so, and you can display it with different colors according to the device. What we did at Xilinx is that we use the OpenCL interoperability of SQL to add OpenCL interoperability to TensorFlow by a side effect. So basically, now you can specify, oh, I want this executed on this SQL device, and you can specify a file name to a OpenCL kernel to be executed inside the TensorFlow. So with this native operation. And what is interesting is that for us, is that it allows to enable more stuff inside the TensorFlow. For example, we can do something which is not possible in TensorFlow. For example, use some already optimized kernels that will be synthesized for some FPGAs. For example, in that case, that will be only use 1 bit weight and 2 bit data for the activation. And that means that you can really have a lot of almost 9 teraops per second, and also with a very low latency, which is not possible to achieve with GPUs, for example. And then, for example, this kind of code can run on AWS F1, an Amazon service providing some Xilinx FPGAs. So we can do some fancy stuff. So, SQL, to conclude, is a generic heterogeneous programming model, and actually, it's so generic that it could target not only OpenCL, but whatever you want. Actually, I'm looking, for example, to use OpenAMP to control our other ARM cores, and it's pretty easy to retarget, and for example, to address all the parts we have in this kind of chips. So, SQL brings heterogeneous computing to modern C++, as you saw. And since it's pure C++, basically it provides a continuous evolutionary path between old C-style application that you can transform into a postmodern C++ implementation. We think that nowadays we need open source implementation for acceptance of new standards, and TriSQL is one of them, or it's still ongoing, but we can already use some fancy devices such as FPGAs, and even if you do not use the device compiler, the interoperability mode of SQL with OpenCL enable you to use a lot of other existing OpenCL code in a fancier way. And we have some SQL Parallel STL implementation. Parallel STL is a C++ 17 version of the STL that can be accelerated with TriSQL. And as you saw, TensorFlow is working with SQL. And it's open source, so you can participate if you want to progress on modern C++. That's it. Do you have some questions? Yeah.